Hello. Hi, everybody. Come on up and get settled in. We have a lot of seats in the front. Great. Welcome. Thanks for joining us this evening. We have a very cool and exciting program with two wonderful speakers that are going to talk about launching a really new initiative, and I think this is such a fitting place because we're at the New York Academy of Sciences, and this project that you'll be hearing about tonight from EcoHealth Alliance and our friends is about really big science, and you can't beat the view here because here we are in New York City, and we've got a big view, and an organization hosting us here tonight, New York Academy of Sciences, that has a big, huge view about the importance of science. And we want to talk to you about rolling out a huge global initiative to really understand our biology and preventing the next pandemics. So we have two speakers. They're going to take turns tonight with us to present this. We have Dr. Dennis Carroll, who's the Director of Global Health Security and Development at USAID, and Dr. Peter Daszak, who's the president of EcoHealth Alliance. So the two of them, we're going to turn the floor over tonight and roll out this program. You're kind of the guinea pig audience to test out what your thinking is on some of these really big ideas. So we'd love to have your input as we close this evening and get your thinking about where we can go with this, what are some other applications, what are the big implications of this work. So with that, I'll just turn it over to Dennis.
Great. First off, thank you all for coming out. We did this about a week and a half ago in Washington on Friday night, and we know in Washington on Friday night there's nothing else to do but to come to presentations like this. New York's a bit more competitive, so we really appreciate the opportunity to have this discussion with you. This is really a socialization exercise. We are looking to have a broader discussion. We've had an opportunity over the last decade to invest in some very significant and serious work in the field that has led us to a place where we think we're in a position to be talking much more aggressively and be much more forward-leaning about how, as a society, a community, a species, we address these issues of emerging pandemic threats. And so what we're going to present to you today is really our thinking about why we need to think differently about the threats that are around us and the opportunities we have to really capitalize on some really fundamental new thinking that has come our way by virtue of the work that we and others have been doing over the last decade, and present to you then where we think this might lead us, where the opportunities might be, and how we might in 10 years be in a position to be far less vulnerable to the emergence of future viral threats. With that said, it's always good to start off with a quote. And this is a quote, I'm not sure, there was a sort of a philosopher prince offered this one up. And it's really profound when you think about it for a moment. And it's, there are known knowns. These are the things we know that we know. There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things that we know we don't know. But there are also unknown unknowns. These are the things we don't know we don't know. How many people in this room know who that philosopher prince is? All right. Whoop, went the wrong way. Donald Rumsfeld. Gold can come from the most miraculous places. I offer this quote up because it's really this part that is really at the heart of what we're going to be talking about today. There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things we know we don't know. We're going to be talking about viruses. And what we would like to do, Peter and I will be presenting this, but this is a body of work that we have two other colleagues that we want to acknowledge, both Jonna Matzett and Nathan Wolf, all of whom are part of a program that USAID is pleased to be partner with, and that's PREDICT, which is really trying to better understand future risks with an opportunity to understand opportunities for future mitigation. So, the Global Virome Project, how can we end the pandemic era? What I'd like to do is just start off by giving you the end story and six take-home thoughts. The first is that we need to understand that this century we're in today is at a period unprecedented. We're in a period of accelerating disease emergence at rates and in dynamics that are unprecedented. And what we also know, and we've seen it play itself out from influenzas to Ebola to Zika, the world is ill prepared to respond to these emerging threats. And what we clearly have learned from our failure is that the capacity to deploy effective countermeasures is limited by what we don't know. Go back to that known and unknown, what we don't know about future threats. With that said, as I mentioned, over the last decade, we've been making investments about viral discovery. And in the course of that, the PREDICT project has really established a proof of concept that allows us to begin to understand the feasibility of characterizing the planet's highest consequence viral threats. That is, making the unknown known. And with that, we are proposing a global virome project that will build on this proof of concept and within 10 years enable the world to dramatically reduce the threat of emerging diseases. These are the six take-home points I want to leave you with. We'll walk you through why each of these points really stands on its own. The last point, success will require changing from a culture that is reactive to one as prepared. One part of the discussion today is about discovery and characterization, knowledge. But what we know is right thinking doesn't lead to right action. There is another step in this, and we need to change the culture of being reactive to being forward-leaning and prepared. So one part knowledge, one part cultural transformation. So, what do we know? What we fundamentally know is when we talk about the 21st century being an unprecedented situation with respect to emerging threats, we can't have this discussion without recognizing that we live in a world that is unprecedented in terms of the footprints established by our species. There are 7.2, 7.3 billion people on this planet. But it's hard for us to really fathom what that means. You know, there's that saw about a frog. And if you take a frog and put it in a boiling water, it will leap out of that water. But if you take that same frog and put it in ambient temperature water and slowly crank up the temperature, it'll boil to death. Our failure to get a real grasp and understanding about how this radical change in population in just the last century alone, what that means in terms of our planet and what it means in terms of the ecosystems we live in. When I was born on this earth, there were 2.4 billion people. In my lifetime, 5 billion additional people have been added. And what we know is that that increasing human population has consequences. Our footprint has consequences. And that has to do, you can't have 7 billion people without radically changing the magnitude of the settlements that we have to create, the increased domestic animal protein, the need for food security, and all of the consequences of increased animal production. Similarly, in terms of increased crop production, feeding 7 billion people is unprecedented. And lastly, we can't have the very economies that we have without considering the natural resources that fuel and drive virtually everything that we live with today, increasing natural resources. And collectively, They all drive habitat change. And we know habitat change is the single biggest predictor that increases animal-human interaction. What we're talking about are zoonotic diseases. Virtually all of the emergent diseases that we've dealt with over the last decade, absent antimicrobial resistance, are zoonotic viruses. And when we look at the consequences of our place on this earth over the last century, and we think about how dramatically that has forced intensified interactions between animal populations, particularly wildlife, but also wildlife's interaction with domestic livestock animals and with people, we have seen that emerging infectious diseases and zoonosis in particular have been accelerating over the last half century. And when we think about emergence, when we think about where we're going, not where we've been, what we know is that emergence is intensifying. And it's important to, again, grasp that the level of increase of human population over the last half century has just been extraordinary. But when we think about where we're going, we haven't stopped that expanded footprint. There'll be 9.6 billion people by 2050 and over 11 billion people by the beginning of the 21st century. All of that is going to have significant consequence in terms of animal, human, environmental dynamics. And it's those dynamics that speak to the 21st century having an unprecedented epidemiologic transition that speaks to the human race is faced with the challenges of emerging infectious diseases on a scale and with globalization, unprecedented. What we also know, and again, I mentioned Ebola, I mentioned Zika. What we know is that developing countermeasures after emergence leaves the world vulnerable to the worst consequences. I'm going to walk you through a slide here that basically is a teaching moment that was never taught, a lesson never learned. H1N1 pandemic virus 2009. And what we have here is the planet. What I'm going to show you is a time lapse based on WHO data of where H1N1 cases were confirmed around the world over time, beginning with the first case in April 2009 and ending April 2010, and it's how rapidly this particular virus spread as an influenza virus around the world. First case, Mexico. We're watching the transition. And up in the right-hand corner is time, I forgot to mention. So by May 18th, we're on virtually every continent. By June 11th, 73 countries are reporting H1N1, and the WHO declares a global pandemic. And within 1 year after the emergence of this virus, there are 2 billion people infected. Not exposed, infected. Think about countermeasures. The next slide is exactly the same map that I showed you before, the same time lapse period. But in the right-hand corner is global vaccine production for H1N1. And what we have on the left-hand side is the millions of doses that were produced, and on the right-hand side, the percentage of the population of the globe that would benefit, assuming it got to the place at the point of production, at the time of production. So as we watch the spread of this virus over time across the planet, our principal biomedical countermeasures against influenzas is the vaccine. Ask yourself, had this been a 1918 virus, the role that the vaccine would have played in terms of protecting and reducing the impact against this particular virus. First detection, April 9. Again, we're watching the progressive movement over time. May 1st, 2009, it's already on three continents. By May, we have a seed strain in early June. By September 20th, 2009, we basically are in safety trials. The virus has already spread. It is now beginning its second wave into North America. And what we're seeing is that the vaccine production begins August, early September. Six months after this virus emerged, early on in the second wave of this virus in North America, there is enough vaccine produced for 7% of the world's population. This is in the midst of an absolutely enormous global effort to create vaccine for this virus. 1 year after it emerges, 12 months, 2 billion people later, infected, 17%. That's produced. That's not shipped. That's not off the tarmacs. That's not into the health facilities. The only point I'm trying to make is that when we talk about mobilizing biomedical countermeasures after something's emerged, influenza is the best example that we have for vaccine production. There's no other vaccine that we produce as quickly, as efficiently, and it's lower cost as influenza's. We still don't have vaccines for MERS, for SARS, HIV. You know, the challenge we have is understanding, for as powerful and as important vaccines are, the limitations that they play when we have a virus spreading around the world quickly. With that said, EPT Predict has dramatically expanded what we know about viral diversity, viral ecology, and risk. First part is why we have to begin thinking differently. Second part is what it is that we're beginning to see that allows us to think differently.
Pleasure to talk to you all. So what do we know about pandemics? And do we know enough to actually begin to understand them, to predict them, and ultimately prevent them? And this is the pitch that I'm giving to you tonight. I think we do know enough. We have enough science to really start to predict them and ultimately prevent them if we do it in the right way, if we work together as a global community. So first of all, when you've got a threat that's global, if you can work out where the highest risk is, you can allocate your resources to that place so you've got a more efficient use of what limited resources we've got. So we've done the science behind this, and we've shown pretty convincingly, and by the way, this is a new version of our emerging disease hotspot model. Toph is at the back of the room there. He's responsible for this with Carlos, who's around. It's not published yet. You're the second audience to see it. And what it shows is where the next emerging zoonotic disease is most likely to emerge. Now, as Dennis said, almost all previous pandemics have either emerged directly from wildlife or through some wildlife bridge through livestock into people. So wildlife origin viruses are responsible for almost all recent pandemics. They're the highest risk on the planet. So looking at these pathogens over the past 40 years, we can show with good science that the where people are on the planet, where wildlife are on the planet, and where people are changing the environment on the planet, and this new factor that's come out in our latest analysis, change in pasture represents land use change. So where people are rapidly developing the landscape and changing it and coming into contact with wildlife seems to be the highest risk for emerging diseases. So that's good. We can now target those places, and this is exactly what the EPT program does. Now, here's some work that's not published yet. This is in review with Nature right now. Kevin Olivelle's in the audience. He's done a bunch of work over the past couple of years trying to say which species are responsible for the riskiest viruses. Which do we pick them up from? If we go to a wildlife habitat and start hunting bats, are we more likely to catch new viruses than if we go there and hunt, I don't know, sloths or some other species? Well, actually, yes. So when you do the analysis, it's species that are closely related to us phylogenetically. Bats, primates, rodents are the highest risk for new emerging zoonoses. They represent by far the majority of the new pathogens that have emerged in people. So they're the ones we target. They're the ones we go out and look at and try and identify new viruses from. And I want to show you some proof of concept behind this of how we can actually do this work. In fact, using this, by just following the math, following the science and the analysis really, really cleverly and coming up with new ways to do some of these analyses, we can actually predict where the missing zoonoses are. So if you're interested in doing surveillance, we can say fairly convincingly that if you go to some parts of, say, Borneo or central West Africa, you're likely to find a whole series of zoonoses that we don't yet know about that are they're in bats. So we can actually get to some of the numbers that are out there. We also know which people are in line to be the first to catch a new virus when it emerges. And that's really important because that means if we're allocating health resources globally to the people who are most at risk, most in need of those for pandemic risk, we should go to these frontline places. And this is an example. This is in Yunnan province, China, where we found evidence of a whole series of SARS-like coronaviruses in bats that seem to be starting to spill over into populations who live very close to bats. Some of them hunt bats, some of them live right near to bat caves. And actually, you know, even without vaccines, it's pretty straightforward to reduce the risk of these pathogens spilling over. If you hunt bats and those bats carry a new virus that looks like SARS, probably that's a high risk to be infected. So working with people in these high-risk interfaces to change behavior is another strategy, even without a vaccine or a new drug. So what have we done over the past, 7 years now with Predict? Well, here's an example. So working with Ian Lipkin's lab, Simon Anthony in the room as well, and other labs around the world, we've found about 1,000 viruses. This is in really 3 years' work early on. The number is much higher now. 800 of them are novel, 182 of them are known. Now, that's quite a few viruses. And we only know short sequences of those viruses, so we know where they fit on a phylogenetic tree. We don't really know much about them. So how do we decide which ones are important? Well, first of all, let's look at what's known. So just look at primates. So we know there's been a lot of research on primates. The red are new viruses we've found. The blue are known viruses that we identified. So you can see we're actually substantially increasing the diversity, the known diversity of viruses from primates. Look at bats. That's incredible. We're massively increasing, at least an order of magnitude, a couple of orders of magnitude higher. So this is a significant addition to the viral catalog on the planet, just with a few years' work at quite a low effort. But how do we know which one is likely to be risky? So you can't really know that. But what you can do is you can move down a sort of triage key. And we've started to set up this approach, looking at traits that are independent of the virus. So what about the host? Does it live in a hot spot for emerging diseases? If it does, that's a higher risk. Is it a species that shows certain traits? Does it hang out near human populations? Does it adapt well to land use change? Is it very abundant? Does it have a high prevalence of the virus? Are a lot of the individuals in a population infected? That all makes it high risk. Very logical, very simple measures to test and then make a decision. We should do more on that virus to find out what it is. And then looking at some of the traits of the virus themselves. Do these viruses, so you find a new virus, does it belong to a viral family that has a high breadth of hosts? Is it able to move from one species to another very easily? What proportion of that family are known to infect people? So these are really simple things that from a sequence you can start to make a decision on, just looking at the viral genetic sequence of whether it could be high risk or not. What we do in Predict is use this triage approach to say, let's do more work on this virus. It's beginning to look like it could be high risk. Here's an example. So if you look at this tree, this is the genetic sequence of a group of viruses. A few years ago, we found some SARS-like viruses, the green ones in the middle, in bats, We thought this was fantastic work. We published it in Science. It was the closest known viruses to SARS, and it seemed to show that SARS emerged from bats. And SARS, by the way, is the top group, the top red ones. Well, since that work and using predict funds, we've been out to China, all across southern China, looking for other SARS-like viruses, and we've now found literally dozens of them. And lo and behold, we've found them that are closer and closer to SARS, to the point that we now have SARS-like viruses that we can show in the lab bind to the host cells that SARS binds to. It uses the same receptor. So this is actually capable, probably, of infecting human cells. So here's a bat virus, almost identical to SARS, that's capable of infecting human cells, which our previous bat viruses weren't. So that's a clear and present danger. So this is an example of how you can move from viral discovery to triage to say, let's do more work on that virus. Let's look into the population that live where these bats live, and let's start testing them to see if they've got antibodies to SARS-like viruses to show that this virus is beginning to move into the human population. But there are issues. It's not straightforward. We also know there are about 6,000 viral species known to infect animals, plants, bacteria. There are probably many, many others. We don't know how many. Of those, about 590 are from mammals, about 188 zoonotic. It gives you a range of about 31.9 to 43% of viruses are capable of moving into people from the ones we know. That's a high proportion. It's about a third to almost a half can jump over into people from mammals. But again, we don't know the number of unknowns. We do know that the rate of spilling over from wildlife into people is accelerating, and given the global population growth and the way we're changing the landscape, it's absolutely inevitable that over the next few decades we will see more potentially pandemic zoonotic viruses move into people. And it's inevitable if we wait long enough without doing anything new, they're all going to spill over and we will have pandemics. So what we're really proposing here is a way to know thine enemy and actually try to do something about it. So, can we find out the number of unknowns? Now, this is something when Kevin Olivelle started working for me a few years ago, I said to him, every week I'm going to ask you the same question. Have you found a way to work out the number of unknown viruses on the planet yet? And I did this. I mean, it got a bit boring. I enjoyed it. But it really took a few years to come up with a strategy. And you can see the number of people we ended up working with. So it's a very good collaboration among lab virologists, theoretical virologists, mathematicians, modelers, analysts, and people working in the field doing the work. This is how it happened. So John Epstein over at the back, he's been working in Bangladesh for a few years, catching these giant fruit bats. Massive, they're quite cute. I shouldn't run them down. They're really cute animals. But they've got big wings and big teeth, and they carry nasty viruses. So there's a lot going against them. And what we did is we thought, well, there's a strategy in conservation. You're trying to find out the number of tigers in a patch of forest, and you go in and catch one, and you mark it, and you release it, and then you try and catch more. You're never going to catch that one that's right in the middle of the forest. It just is very shy. But what you do is you start to recapture the original ones, and there's a simple equation that ecologists use to predict the number of unknown tigers based on the number of marked and recaptured tigers. So we did the same with viruses. We repeatedly sampled, this John Epstein did all the work, repeatedly sampled over almost 2,000 of these giant fruit bats, individually caught them, anesthetized them, bled them, took swabs, put them onto liquid nitrogen, brought them back to the US. Took them into Ian Lipkin's lab, where Ian and Simon did in-depth viral discovery using the same strategy over and over again on these samples. And we started discovering new viruses. And eventually, we started discovering most of them. Then we started finding some of the same ones. So we got this strategy where we can now predict the number of unknown viruses. And just note the shape of that discovery curve, asymptotic. So it goes up, and then it levels off. Now, eventually, somewhere over here, is the final virus, but it's going to be very hard to find. But we can predict it now. So we found 55 new viruses from 9 viral families, all of them known to contain risky human pathogens in this fruit bat. And we predicted 58 viruses. If you extrapolate, and now Simon's done this for macaques as well, so we can do this quite accurately. There are about 1.33 million unknown viruses in mammals on the planet. If you include all influenzas from water birds, they're a high-risk group. We know that almost, we sort of assume that influenzas are likely to spill over into people if they exist. So we come up with this number, about 1.33 million unknown viruses. Sounds like a lot. Well, is it a lot? How long would it take us to find them? And how many of those would be zoonotic if we left them to emerge? So let's say we did nothing, we carried on doing our stuff on this planet, destroying the habitat, eating wildlife, growing our populations, generally having a wonderful time, they would all eventually emerge. That's 540 to 700,000 new viruses. One of those is going to get us. So I think this is a worthwhile strategy. But is it doable? Is it feasible? Now, the great thing about this work is we've got excellent accounting of our funds, how much it costs to discover, to go out to these countries, to set up the field logistics, to catch an animal, to sample it, for everything from the rubber gloves to the liquid nitrogen to the in-depth viral discovery. And we know how many samples we would have to take to get to that 1.33 million. So in the fruit bat, we collected about 1,092 samples to detect 75% of the unknown viruses. It would actually take us double to get 99% because of that long tail on the discovery. It becomes harder and harder to get the last few. It would take a lot more, 7,000, to get the last 1%. Now, that last 1% is probably pretty rare. Pretty rare viruses. By logic, that's a lower risk of them emerging. Let's extrapolate that to the 1.33 million unknown viruses on the planet. It would cost $6.4 billion. It's about $1.2 million per species, about $6.4 billion to discover 100% of all unknown zoonotic potential viruses. It's a lot of money, but think about it. SARS, one single virus, cost our global economy something between $10 and $50 billion. 1.3% drop in GDP in Southeast Asia, some countries. Huge loss of travel, trade, and commerce because of one single spillover event from one single new virus. One person in a wildlife market handling a civet or a bat that got infected and spread the virus. Okay, 6.4 billion. For you, think about it. We go back to our viral discovery curve. Well, let's go for 99%. All of the vast majority of the nasty ones, only 3.44 billion, a bargain. Now, 3.44 billion is still a lot of money. But let's look at it as a 10-year project. Annualize that over 10 years. That's $344 million a year. Begins to sound reasonable. Not only that, but early on in the project, let's say 2 years in, because of the shape of that curve, we're going to already discovered half of them. By 4 years, we've got 75%. So those new viral sequences can start to be used to do some triage, to find out which ones are likely to infect human cells, to go back out into the field and do some more in-depth characterization, and to start to develop vaccines, medical countermeasures, behavioral change programs to stop them emerging. So we get an early return on investment. Well, how much return on investment will we get? Can we actually predict that? What we do know, and there's a paper published in PNAS, Pike et al., a couple of years ago, where we looked at the exponential growth of pandemics and the exponential growth in cost, the economic cost, the economic damages that viruses like SARS and influenza pandemic do to our global commerce. So if you look over a 30-year period from now into the future, and just look at the number of viruses that are going to emerge, because we've got good data on that, and the damages they would cause, it's about $204 billion. It's a lot of money, and a lot of lives lost. That's harder to predict. Let's think about the GVP period, which is the first 10 years, the Global Virome Project. Let's say viral discovery reduces damages by 10%. So let's say we start discovering this 50-75% of viruses very early on, and we actually find out there really is a really risky new virus that's going to emerge, and we can stop it somehow. We can get some isolation quarantine put up around a hospital where people are showing evidence of this virus. We've got a PCR test, so we find very early on in the outbreak, because we're there working with the hospitals, that these people are infected by a new pathogen, and we manage to contain it. One single SARS event, and we instantly save a lot of money. So with a 10% reduction, we already get a great return on investment, 3 times return on investment, $17 billion over 30 years, just in economic damages saved. If we reduce it by 50%, let's say we get a really nice new medical countermeasure that goes to a basal viral group that starts to work against a group of different coronaviruses, then we get some real savings, $86 billion, and no doubt lives saved by this approach. So we believe it's going to have good return on investment. It's probably going to have even more, and Dennis will get into that in a minute. So let's just recap. We're saying that a global investment of $344 million a year will identify all high-consequence viruses, essentially, because there'll be 1% of those zoonotic ones, the rare ones, not found. We'll discover the majority in the first few years, and we'll start to work on medical countermeasures, and hopefully something will hit quickly. We'll do this in a way which builds on current platforms. We've already set up in over 20 countries now these viral discovery platforms with excellent gold standard support from Ian's lab and a few others around the world to do this work. We know which species to target, where to target them. We can hone down this approach in a very targeted way. And not only that, it won't just discover risky new viruses and suggest ways to stop them. It will also allow us to put in place measures that could help reduce the risk of endemic zoonoses. So we'll be out there in remote Borneo, as we have done, building labs to test people who suffer from endemic zoonoses, rabies and others. So we save lives that way too and reduce the cost of those outbreaks as well. So there's an extra return on investment. And let's just look at a model for this, the Human Genome Project, where, and there's some controversy, but estimates of up to $178 return per dollar invested in the Human Genome Project. We believe it may be even more than that because these things cost so much to our global trade, travel, and our lives that it's really going to be a significant return. So I'm going to hand back to Dennis to tell us how we're going to do this project. So over to you, Dennis.
Great. Peter, thank you. Okay, so we've talked about what it takes to acquire new knowledge. How do we translate that acquisition into a new way of behaving and acting? Again, another quote, Albert Einstein. You can never go wrong quoting Albert Einstein. And here, we can't solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created them. This is really a challenge that if we really want to reap the full benefits of all of the information that Peter was presenting a few moments ago, we need to think differently. So as I said at the beginning, one part knowledge, one part thinking differently. And what we're going to offer is how do we exploit this knowledge to create a different way of thinking, different way of acting, and ultimately a different way of moving into the 21st century. So what we're proposing, we've called it the Global Virome Project, Viral Biome Project, as a global initiative to characterize the virome in all unknown high-consequence viruses within 10 years. A global effort, 10-year action. The approach, first and foremost, is about fostering global ownership. Peter mentioned the Human Genome Project. Well, I could have been the sole donor for the Human Genome Project. I think many of you know that when we look at that map that Peter showed, we would have to, the effort will include vast majority of the countries in the world. And not only will it involve them, the benefits and the ownership need to involve them. So it needs to be inherently an approach that fosters global ownership. It needs to build a global alliance. This is very different than a country or a group of countries of the G8 or G20, or an agency such as my own. This is really about fostering a way of harnessing global ownership, global capacity. And it's really about looking across the full range of stakeholders, contributors, to be able to move this agenda forward. Peter mentioned the opportunity for scale-up is extraordinary. There are already pre-existent platforms out there. And the opportunity to begin crowdsourcing existing networks of wildlife and conservation groups, really to begin the survey and to capture the information. Similarly, the ability to crowdsource existing global laboratory networks, again, and cloud-based information portals to perform the sample analysis and modeling, limiting the need for new infrastructure investments. The key is standardizing protocols and procedures within the context of global ownership. The results, a comprehensive catalog of the planet's highest priority viruses, making the unknown known. Thank you, Donald Rumsfeld, right? And this has really two domains. The first is we have the opportunity to identify viral distribution across animal species and their potential for interaction with human populations or their domestic animals. The viral ecology. Knowing the viral ecology, first off, allows us to ground truth predictive models of viral emergence. That's critical in terms of being able to target where we go and how we do it. But it also allows us to begin targeting preventive measures, those risk mitigation. All of the events that we're talking about that have the potential to play themselves out, they are not a necessary event. They are an inadvertent consequence of about how we have established ourselves on this planet. They are malleable. And by understanding risks, understanding the viral ecology, allows us to be much more strategic in terms of targeting preventive measures against populations, places, animals, and people, and the practices with the greatest risk. We can bend the curve of risk simply by knowing the viral ecology. But if we also accelerate the pace of viral discovery, it will lead to parallel advances in genomics, modeling, diagnostics, and virology. What we're saying here is that by putting down the gauntlet that the globe is committing itself to do this venture, the very act of moving forward creates an energy field for really stimulating sort of the global community to accelerate what we know genomically, having the technologies and the modeling and the diagnostics available to really exploit that acquisition of discovery. You know, the sheer numbers that would be coming out over the first 5 years create an opportunity to really energize the most creative forces within our species to really bring collective problem solving to thinking about solutions we haven't even put on the table yet. But this would act as an energizer. And it would allow us to stratify newly characterized viruses into categories of risk, biologic risk. The column above is about behavioral risk, but the ability to disaggregate and begin understanding which among those 500 to 700,000 really speak to that potential for wreaking havoc within our societies. And it allows for even more targeted mitigation and countermeasure development, not just prevention, but thinking innovatively and creatively about what the toolbox for biomedical countermeasures might look like and having them positioned in advance. This issue about always reacting, responding to events after they emerge, the possibility of establishing toolboxes that have the resilience to speak to the risks that we have been able to document. The long-term benefits, as Peter mentioned, are enhanced laboratory capacities, certainly around viral discovery, viral characterization. They speak to enhanced conservation wildlife surveillance capacities, being able to harness that collective body of expertise through crowdsourcing speaks to a global capacity that doesn't exist today, but clearly can exist over the next decade. And that allows us, as a legacy of crowdsourcing, to begin to repurpose and broaden for new ventures at the end of the Global Virome Project. There are many questions and challenges that are out there that these platforms would lend themselves towards. It would also, by virtue of global ownership, strengthen global architecture, including legal and policy frameworks for future global partnerships. These are not one-off ventures. They really bring a coherent commitment against things that we do not do well today. And building global alliances across industry, academics, policymakers, and financiers. Again, establish a new way of working together. And ultimately, enabling capacity building for new zoonosis and endemic diseases in the countries where the need is greatest. The challenge, however, as I said, is translating new knowledge about the viral biome into a new toolbox based on risk, not just immediate threat. We are an immediate threat species as of now, but for us to really provide the level of protection as we move into this century, we need to recalibrate how we approach risk and make risk the basis for toolbox development. The opportunity for prevention based on risk is building systems of prevention. Clearly, the role of livestock in spreading and amplifying new viral threats, exploiting what we already know about what lowers the risks of those livestock productions and creating safer and more healthy marketing and production. The building of a culture of risk mitigation and municipal design and extractive industries. At the very beginning, I talked about as a consequence of our increasing population, our settlements are encroaching in ways that create risk between the neighboring wildlife domains and our new urban and peri-urban settlements. To begin developing urban and peri-urban settlements that have built into them the kind of eco-friendly environments that mitigate risk. And I just want to pause for a second to say, creating what in essence is a one, what we call now a One Health approach, multi-sectoral approach, is not new. For as much as we talk among ourselves as this is an almost impossible challenge, go back 180 years ago, at another point of a tremendous epidemiologic transition, at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, when village communities were moving into urban settlements and bringing with them village infrastructure for water, for sewage. And what we saw in London in the 1830s and 1840s were the consequences. Village infrastructure in urban London wreaked havoc in terms of communicable diseases. And it was a consequence of John Snow being able to look beyond the illness and look at the source that led to a reimagining what urban settlements were going to be. You could not have had the Industrial Revolution with the concentration of human capital within urban settings unless urban design embraced a One Health paradigm, unless you brought in water management specialists, sewage specialists, urban design specialists. That is an example of One Health that we don't, in this city of all places, don't take for granted. The issues that we're dealing with now is another 21st century variant on that, an epidemiologic transition, a consequence of our footprint. It's not a matter of village infrastructure. It's the way we access food security. It's the way we access the natural wealth. It's the way we build our settlements. So the opportunity to build systems of prevention, we've done it before, we can do it again. Whoop. And biomedical countermeasures. Not only do we have the opportunity to prevent future risk, we have the opportunity to change a culture of what is in and what's in the toolbox. Investing in countermeasure development well in advance of a future epidemic. Again, go back to that rapidly spreading H1N1 virus to understand the vulnerabilities we have when we design our countermeasures in the midst of an epidemic or pandemic. And it allows us to build a database on available and effective countermeasures against the highest risk viruses. We can test and evaluate what we have now against what we discover. And it also allows us to exploit new data for novel countermeasure strategies. Talking with some of you in here today, the work that you're doing on family level interventions, certainly in terms of vaccine production, how do we accelerate that? How do we create a much more robust long-term approach to exploiting the information that comes out of this discovery to develop biomedical countermeasures? And ultimately, it's about tapping into that incredible pool of next generation thinking about what in fact is available. How do we exploit novel discoveries like the CRISPR gene towards addressing these challenges? What else is out there that creates new opportunities for us to think differently about the future? And the issue of building global ownership, this is clearly one of the most challenging issues faced here, because it speaks to governance, global governance. It speaks to information and data sharing. It speaks to sample sharing and issues around equitable access to products. Laurie, you clearly were privy to the incredible dynamics around the influenza sample sharing dilemma. And it was a legitimate issue. As we saw when I showed you that 17% of the vaccines for the global population, if you looked where those vaccines actually went, it was not to the populations at greatest risk. That's another storyline altogether. So the issues, we do have examples of where equitable access to products, where equitable access to products have been built into global architecture, certainly with the pandemic influenza preparedness framework, PIP. What do they tell us about how we address the other 22 high consequence viral families to create that level of ownership, shared benefits? And then the issues around the Nagoya Protocol, again, a global framework for navigating very tricky legal issues. Ultimately, it's about changing a culture of reaction. And we need to forge alliances with conservation and animal husbandry sectors to begin to think differently and engage technology and data management innovators to catalyze advances in diagnostics, modeling, and genomics. Having the global Virome project not be simply a matter of discovery, it's a matter of catalyzing new investments, new ways of thinking about problem solving. And it's about incorporating the makers and users of biomedical countermeasures into the design of what GVP needs to accelerate the development of the next generation of countermeasures. And ultimately, it's about building an alliance with decision makers, funders, financiers to invest in risk and empower a culture of preparedness. So, let's go back to two slides. What's the urgency? And the urgency is that we see moving forward is inevitable. And what we see looking back is what we'll still be doing 10 years from now if we don't embrace an effort, a global effort, to discover and use the discovery of the viral biome and use that to create new approaches, new ways of thinking about prevention, about risk mitigation, and about control. And ultimately, if you substitute virus for enemies, it is said if you know your enemies and know yourself, you will not be imperiled in 100 battles. If you do not know your enemies but do know yourself, you will win one and lose one. If you do not know your enemies nor yourself, you will be imperiled in every single battle. Knowing the unknown is doable, making that new knowledge the basis for new action is the basis for winning every battle. Thank you very much.
Could we get one more round of applause for our two speakers? That was fabulous. And I feel like I typically give a very understated introduction, which I think I did, given the quality of those presentations. It's a big deal. And we already know we have about 1 billion people every year getting endemic zoonotic diseases around this planet. It's about 15% of the population, and they're preventable. And what Peter and Dennis were just talking about is the fact that we can do something about this getting even worse. And it's not a lot of money. We talk about, really, we're talking about pennies to prevent pandemics. So everybody would say, for the cost of a cup of Starbucks. We're actually talking, just for Americans, like a cost of deli coffee. And we're not even talking about the U.S. picking up the burden of this. We already have the Chinese engaged in chipping in. We're talking the Europeans. We're now talking about the cost of a Splenda packet once a year, really to save a horrible direction for the planet. So it's doable when you start to look at the science, when we really use some evidence. It's not such a big problem that we have to run away from it, which a lot of people want to do, say, it's too big, we can't deal with this. It's not. It's big, but we can deal with it. So from that, I just really get our two speakers up here and open it up to questions. So let's have a good discussion about some of these issues. Thank you.
Again, as we said, this is sort of like a...
Can you go to the microphone, please?
Yeah, there's a microphone right there if you can go there. This is an automobile that's still under production. So your feedback is...
But it's a Rolls-Royce, though,
very,
isn't it?
Very well walking. Yes, but is it a Chinese Rolls-Royce?
First of all, that was a wonderful presentation. Thank you. I look at the increase in population. I look at the limited area of the Earth. And then I take a look at what will eventually be some starvation in many areas, mitigation of drinking water that is clean and safe. And I think what percentage of this earth is being used for meat production so far as not just the meat, but the crops grown to feed the meat relative to the amount of people that would be fed and that would therefore not be starving and more susceptible to these zoonotic diseases, and to what degree that these animals that are being fed corn in particular, which is not necessarily what they would traditionally eat, become vectors of disease in that they are downer cows, sick chickens, whatever it is, hogs that carry various diseases. And to what degree is it important to consider creating information for people about perhaps limiting the eating of meat vis-a-vis other food sources? I mean, it's astounding if you look over time in the population growth, and what will eventually be starvation in certain areas. And you're going to have that many more people who are invading the rainforest and invading other lands that are available to cut and slash to keep producing the grain and the area for the meat. So what is your reaction?
Well, you've convinced me. Look, as a vegetarian, I believe in tofu nation myself. So it's the opportunity in the course
That's
of having discussions, thinking about best practices. We have another part of our portfolio that's trying to anticipate increased livestock animal protein demand in Africa between now and 2050 and what that might translate into, not only in terms of zoonosis, but impact on methane production, impact on water, environmental degradation. And all of this begs the question about how can we be smarter, more efficient. It's not simply about zoonosis. Rearing livestock and dealing with the inappropriate use of antibiotics and the consequences, 80% per volume of per weight of antibiotic use in this United States comes by way of the livestock industry. So I think it's an opportunity to create a portal for addressing a much larger agenda. So the halo effect potentially is much more significant, I think, to address a lot of the questions that you're raising. Again, you can have a huge impact on climate change. You can have a huge impact on water degradation, particularly in parts of the world where water is scarce and people have limited access to potable water. Better management of your environment across the board. So all of this is, again, that issue of all of these things are unintended consequences. You can get the benefits that you need. You can achieve food security without having to wreak havoc on the environment. It's about being smarter. So, sorry. Laurie.
Hi. Well, I have a huge number of reactions, but let me narrow it down. First of all, very exciting, and this obviously should happen. Secondly, I assume you're talking to the Earth microbiome people. If you're not, I sure hope you will, because they actually have a ton of money. And it's a logical thing that this is part of the microbiome, the Virome, which takes me to the third thing. You seem to have decided to limit your threat analysis to terrestrial settings, terrestrial ecologies, terrestrial mammals. And I'm not sure why you're doing that, given that a heck of a lot of danger comes from oceanic and river systems. And you also seem to be defining virus in an interesting way, that it sounds like you're excluding phage and plasmid horizontal transfer, which means you're eliminating looking at zoonotic transmission of resistance factors, things of that nature. And I would argue that's an error. And then finally, in your, you know, bang up pitch at the end of whatever the world will get out of this and why this is going to be so spectacular, I would put one strong word of warning about oversell. And it's this. We have known a particular virus very well for well over 100 years. It's one of our best known viruses out there. We have a vaccine that only costs 19 cents. And yet we have an absolutely out of control yellow fever epidemic right now in Africa. As of today, DRC has gone into a state of emergency, DRC Congo along with Angola. And so, you know, preparedness is more than knowledge. A great deal more than knowing the enemy. And I think you need to be very careful about the oversell side, which I heard hints of at the end of the talk.
Okay.
So those are mine.
If I could I'll respond to the last point. I absolutely agree with you, but that's why, you know, the issue about prevention and the yellow fever examples that you're giving, you know, the vaccine in this case is a remarkable tool for prevention, but we're not using it smartly. Right.
We're not using it at all.
well, it's used, but it's not used smartly. We're really not exploiting the opportunity essentially to eliminate yellow fever as a threat on this planet, and it's doable. As you said, 19 cents and you know where the disease is. You follow the vector, you'll follow the disease. So I would go, I would say this, to me that speaks to broadening our vision about prevention. What does it take to really harness the full range of things for prevention? Even if it's new vaccines for new things, if you can use them to prevent, it needs to be prevented. I completely agree with you. I was hoping we communicated, and evidently didn't, the balance between preparedness in terms of biomedical countermeasures, prevention in terms of how we use what we can use to prevent things from happening in the first place. So, but your point is well taken.
Yeah, let me add to. So first of all, it's an honor to have you in the audience, Laurie, and I appreciate you coming down. I've got a bad knee too, so but maybe not as bad as yours. So first of all, thumbs up from Laurie Garrett is great. So there was a thumbs up at the beginning. That's good. Your point about terrestrial vertebrates is correct. Yeah, we're trying to triage the risk, and there is a limit to the cost, because if we start to include phage, we start to include aquatic vertebrates, we start to include marine mammals, yeah, there are influenza B and seals and all the rest of it. The risk relative to the added cost would be minimal. However, when we've funded the GVP, we can do add-on, we can do the Laurie Garrett add-on section on aquatic, and for a small amount of money, we'll work out the math. But I think, I mean, I think you appreciate that. At some point, we have to triage to the most highly risky group of pathogens, which are viruses, from usually terrestrial, and bats, of course, we include in that, volant terrestrial mammals.
Well, I would just suggest, since this, you said, is a work in progress, on the governance side, and on your cell, to take your already lovely beginnings of discussing empowerment, stakeholder engagement, and hearkening to the mistakes we've made in the past, you know, as the great white hunter coming into developing countries and saying, give us your microbes, ha, 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 and you shall never get a vaccine from us. All of that is great. You're hinting at all of it, but let's go further. Let's really build right in the front, full out commitments.
Yeah.
Which means engaging not only with projects like Earth Microbiome on the, you know, let's all get out there and look together, but also existing infrastructures that are already in place, like Gavi.
Yeah.
Sitting down with Seth Berkley and saying, you know, how do we start now building so that when there is something in a toolkit or potentially in a toolkit, you're ready to roll with it. I would just add another caveat warning. We actually have now a very effective Ebola vaccine, and no one, not one single government will currently bankroll developing a stockpile. So the next time we have an Ebola outbreak, we're going to have another shitstorm.
Just to let you know, we part of our team, Nathan Wolf, has had discussions with Seth specifically about that issue. So we agree with you completely on that. But we would like to obviously have a chance to talk with you more.
Thanks very much, Laura.
Yeah.
You talked about staging this whole investigation. There are a number of viruses that are already in the human population. There are no resources now to go out and actually find out what they are. So unexplained encephalitis, respiratory disease, gastroenteritis, and so forth. And an early portion of this, and I think which would give you the best bang for your buck early on, would be if you in fact had an allocation for characterization of those viruses that are already causing disease. HIV, for example, simmered for a long time before it exploded. So there are probably things like this which are already in the human population, which means they are capable already of extending in the human population. And this would be an area that clearly merits focus. In addition, there was an early phase where people were talking about specifically looking at those individuals who come into contact with animals that might serve as vectors or reservoirs for these infectious agents. So, you know, these are not only the bushmeat hunters, but, for example, in Saudi Arabia, it's now people who handle camels, for example, every, to my knowledge, every single outbreak in Saudi Arabia can be traced back to someone who has a Bedouin name, suggesting that, in fact, that they had some sort of contact with camels before it then moved and then extended within the human population. So these various, and the last thing I wanted to say is, we always talk about looking at wild animals, but the work we've done most recently in New York, where we were looking at rats and mice, and looking at horses, where we found new Peggy viruses which look very similar to hepatitis C, illustrates the point that some of what we really need to be looking at are some of the very closely related domesticated animals with whom we come into regular contact.
Well, let me make a comment about the livestock. It was shown on one of the bullets very quickly. The numbers that we gave include an allocation for some livestock sampling of in these hotspot regions. There's also going to be some human sampling, and I think we don't get to exactly what you talked about, but we begin to, because we target down the human sampling to the people in the interfaces in the hottest of the hotspots. And what you're saying, which I think is a very good point, if we then look at undiagnosed outbreaks of severe respiratory encephalitis, other syndromes in those areas, we should get some simple early wins. It makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
So NIH says that this is surveillance. The CDC says we can do it all. And basically, nobody covers it.
Yeah.
The AIDS doesn't do it anymore. NIH doesn't do it.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of it in the influenza program that looks at respiratory diseases that are not attributable to flu. But there basically is nobody covering this space. And as you know, Google invested very briefly.
Yeah. Yeah. Extremely logical and convincing.
Hi.
Thanks.
I was just wondering, over the past couple of years, we had several viruses that came up in the news that created a lot of buzz, such as chikungunya, Ebola, and now Zika. And what I'm wondering is, how do you maintain a sense of urgency as far as tackling these issues if you go through a period of several years where you don't have a new virus that is in the news that is causing a storm?
Sadly.
There we go. Answer.
It's not politically correct to say, but Laurie's 110% right. The 10% is the exponential growth on top. So we've done the math on this, and emerging disease events, the things that start emerging diseases off, are driven by exponentially growing factors that Dennis talked about, and they are growing exponentially. We will see them, and we will see more of them, and they will spread quicker, and they will have a bigger impact both in lives lost and the economy. So we're not worried about that. It would be great to stop it. Let's hope for a little bit of a respite.
Yeah, the other, what we didn't talk about, you know, we made reference to pandemic threats. The fact is we saw with Ebola just how economically and socially terrifying Ebola was by virtue of its ability to be globalized in air travel. So a virus with a very low R-naught, its ability to have, the impact in this city in terms of how this city responded to Ebola, the introduction. So, you know, you're talking about epidemic threats having a global impact above and beyond those viruses which are bona fide pandemic threats. They have a much higher efficiency in terms of their ability to transmit. So, you know, it's the frequency of these are going to be coming up, but it's not simply predicated on a pandemic virus. We see that epidemic viruses have a huge global implication as well. And we can't divorce. Look, one of the things that we all have to be prepared with, we talked about the extractive industry and how they create an enormous amount of risk. The events that are going on in DR Congo right now with the opening up of new roadways up into Oriental, sort of a, just by virtue of the species and viral diversity up there, an extraordinary hotspot waiting to happen. Events that used to happen up in Oriental and stay in Oriental are going to very rapidly, by virtue of these roadways being built by the extractive industry, end up in Kinshasa, and they're going to end up in New York City very quickly. So whether or not they're pandemic or epidemic, the issue about fueling the recognition that the economic and the public health and the social impact of these are enormous. This is an extraordinary period of time, both in terms of the frequency, but also the ability of amplification and spreading of things that in the past never would have moved. Well, as we saw Ebola, it never really got out of very localized events in Central Africa. And once it got into a much more globally connected environment, for as much as we don't think of West Africa as being that globally connected, it's far more globally connected than Central Africa is. So.
I just want to thank you and say that I'm not entirely a neophyte in this area, and this has been an incredible eye-opener. It seems to me that one of the things you all need to do is get this out to the press, to the consumer press, not just other medical journals, but to the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, to small publications, to whatever, and really make people more aware of this. I mean, I think that's probably the most important thing you could do right now, is to get people fired up about trying to change the culture that we live in that ignores these facts.
We appreciate that comment. Again, this is the second step in socialization. We do have a paper that we've submitted, but we also, because of global ownership, we want to open this up. So we have a roadshow that will take within the U.S., into Asia, into Africa. We have already, as a way of creating greater awareness, and again, this issue about global ownership is, you know, it's not about speaking to the American or the North American or the European audience. It's also, we live in a small world. So we agree, there's all sorts of levels of engagement that we need to do. And any advice you have, God bless you, we're more than welcome.
Please tweet about us. Is that the right thing to say?
So I'm by no means a specialist in your area, but I'm a specialist for change management. And I think it would be, you made an ample business case for a lay person like me. But what is missing is, in my mind, sort of a hook or a bridge that would enable people to see the a path that you envision of how you will create this global ownership. Because right now, it might be very concrete for you because you have all these examples in your head. It's not concrete for me. It's a great idea. But it would be helpful to have some examples of pilots where you had an impact already, or an example of companies like Google or whoever that have started to buy into this and invest in this, and also to have an emphasis on, other than that a rational thinker would accept this, we know that there are no rational actors in this world. So what kind of business case in terms of self-interest for potential investors in this idea can you create? So I would like to have a little bit more of the movie of how you would implement this. And it can be a complete like fiction. Not really, you have to have the data, but fiction has its place. And a good narrative that creates this bridge would be very helpful for non-scientific minds that look for a return on investment.
Right. I can tell you the movie would not be Contagion. The vaccine came to the rescue far too easily in that one.
Very hard to sell prevention.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
Contributing to something not happening is not a good sell.
Right.
You have to contribute to something that is happening. So how can you create a narrative about something that's happening as opposed to something that's not happening?
You know, let me give you an example of one of the areas that we are working on. And I agree with you. I mean, we need to create some anchors or hooks for this. So absolutely. But let me give you one and see if it resonates. We mentioned the extractive industry, and it's an area that we're concerned about. And so we've opened up a number of different ventures with different members of the extractive industry, oil, petroleum, mining, and have created essentially, you know, one of the things we found out about the extractive industry as a body is that they are they're into risk mitigation right up front. When they design and operate their portfolio, one of the things they want to know at the very beginning, what are the risks they have that could potentially disrupt their portfolio? Any day the operator shut down, they're losing a significant amount of money. So they have in their operational design a whole cadre of people that are about risk. And so we've introduced this whole topic to them as part of their risk portfolio, that if they're moving into these areas where there is the circulation, one of these hotspot areas, then there are things they need to do to understand their risk and things they can do to mitigate against that risk. And so we've actually been field validating this with about three different sort of international corporations that are well known to everyone, as a way of trying to build into their own corporate way of thinking, how they can build this in. One, it's not a good neighbor exercise at all, as opposed to environmental management issues. This is about self-interest, but it's self-interest that has mutual benefits. So we've had some success in that. In moving this forward within the industry. And we're similarly working with the banks that fund the industry to see about, they also have all sorts of conditions built into their loans that speak to these issues. And then lastly, partnering with the ministries that provide the leases, right? How can we work with them? So there is this body of work about prevention around risk, and we've really taken the initial first generation maps that Predict was able to generate and used that as an entry point to speak about risk, and then created tools that are really predicated on the environmental risk, environmental impact toolkits that they've had to work with for the last 25 years, and sort of develop those in ways that have allowed them to think about it. So we've actually had some interesting early success in that direction with some global partners, and we're hoping we can move that forward. So maybe speaking to how, you know, part of the change does have some corporate buy-in at this point. We still have a long ways to go to make the industry, but we're hoping to get a couple of champions within the industry that speak to, again, because it's self-interest, they have huge vulnerabilities anytime there's an outbreak of this, that, and the other.
Let me just make a point about the sort of image of fiction. But, you know, I'm originally from England. You can tell from my accent. So I like Doctor Who. So Doctor Who travels back in time. And we've got a couple of Whovians in the room, a couple of nerds in the room. He travels back in time. So where would you go if you could travel back in time? And I often think about this. Would you go back to the bushmeat hunter, the one bushmeat hunter that sparked off that big pandemic HIV outbreak, the one person that chopped the chimpanzee and just cut his finger, and then the virus got in, and that led to 40 million people dying of a new virus. And would you just go, be able to go back and say, hang on, don't do that, just let that one go, let that animal go, and stop an outbreak. Now, that's the image. Can we do that now? Well, in Bangladesh, we're working with Nipah virus, John Epstein's work, showing that these fruit bats carry Nipah virus, that they're attracted to trees where people scrape the bark and collect the fruit juice. It's a Muslim country. They've got to drink it quick before it starts to ferment and becomes haram, forbidden. So they drink this fresh fruit juice every morning. The bats come at night. We've put infrared cameras on, showed them coming to the tree. They lick the sap. They urinate in the pot, and Nipah is transmitted, and people die. Little kids die because they drink this sort of lethal cocktail. We can do simple things to prevent that. A simple bamboo curtain across the top of those pots stops bats getting in.
Which is what we're doing with them now.
That's what we're actually doing now. Trialing that out through Prevent and through other programs that Dennis is managing with Steve Luby's group. So there are visuals that get to that wishful thinking that we could go back in time and stop HIV. And that is the big one that we all think about when we think about emerging zoonoses. Next question.
Hi, I'm coming at this from I'm coming at this from a very public policy perspective. I'm not a bio or hard science professional, but I do work in the social sciences, and so it seems like you're collecting feedback. I would like to add a plus one to the concerns about maybe having a more concrete pathway for the public-private alliances that you mentioned in your slides. I think a lot of people would argue that those alliances, as you've already talked about in answering these questions, there's some headway being made. But I think it would be helpful to know, like, maybe if you laid them out and then talk about how they can be improved instead of just laying them out as recommendations, because that was very unclear to me. And so maybe you could build on that too. But maybe something that I think could help me as well, and something that I found glaringly absent, was the political context in which all of this is happening. You mentioned globalization in some contexts, in some ways, where you can see the spread of infectious diseases through increased air travel, and that's because a privilege like air travel is now extended to so many different places. But you don't talk about the geopolitical rationale and the reasons, the context for why certain societies are developing so rapidly, that you have urban slums where people are more easily exposed to these diseases. And I found that really lacking in your presentation.
Yeah, that's a good point. Look, the circle is clear. And a great example, we're working in Borneo with palm oil plantations where land use change is going to drive these new viruses. They're going to emerge in the often very, very poorly paid workers on the plantations. And they're then going to spread. And we know from doing the math on this that once they get in the air travel network, they're going to come to the countries that afford the most travel, which is us. So we eventually will get hit by these viruses. What is driving the palm oil plantations? It's our consumption. So, EcoHealth Alliance, our organization, we're a non-profit here in New York. We've made it our two top priorities to deal with deforestation for issues like palm oil production because of the pandemic risk and the wildlife trade. And if you look at the biggest consumer of wildlife on the planet for food is China, eating species to extinction from across Southeast Asia and now Africa. The second biggest consumer of wildlife for pets is the US. So we're trying to tackle both of those industries by a number of different ways. And yes, there are political drivers to those that we need to deal with. They're very hard to deal with, but we're taking those on for the health reason as well as the conservation reason.
Right.
So your point's well taken.
I guess it sounded like you're collecting feedback. That's why I thought I would.
No, it's great. I really appreciate that.
I also wanted to point out, as like from one researcher to another, that it would help if you gave more context to your graphs and explained things like scale. I feel as though some of those things were skipped over, and I think that would greatly help.
No problem. Thanks very much.
Great,
appreciate it.
Thank you.
So I just want to come back for a second and build a little bit on what Carlotta said and what you, sir, said. The need for stories, the need for turning some of these facts and figures into stories that people can understand and become emotionally involved with, I think is incredibly, whether it takes the form of a movie, a film done, or several films. I mean, you've got infinite number of stories here, actually. But they need a good storyteller to turn them into something that will, that people can really react to. I mean, I think that change very often happens at the grassroots, and when you talk to the grassroots, you try to communicate with them on an emotional basis.
Excellent point. I'll modify one of the slides where I talk about stakeholders, and I'll make sure I put storytellers in there. Because that's the ability to communicate in ways that move people to action. So I absolutely agree. I don't mean that facetiously. I think storytelling is a real art form, and it's one that we need to think very carefully about. But what I also want to say is the way we would like to roll this whole discussion out is an iterative way that allows for bringing together those kinds of constituencies. I'm not a storyteller. But there are people out there who are really good. How do we create a body of owners that bring that collective capability to the table and be able to move that forward? So I think the issue about storytelling is really good. And we do have to offset the stories that are false out there. And quite frankly, I think contagion did an enormous disservice where it reinforced the notion that a vaccine just pops out of a machine like a Coca-Cola dispenser. That was the end part of the story, right? And you just kind of go, wow. It makes a lot of other things. People don't realize how vulnerable
they
are.
Well, the real end of contagion was the bit where they went back to the farm and showed where it originated.
That's
where we need to be. That's contagion too, where it all comes from.
It's the prequel. And that's largely we work in the prequel area. So how do we make sure Gwyneth Paltrow never meets that tragic ending? That's what it's all about.
All right. Well, I've been told we should call it a night. So please, I think we can still get a quick cocktail in. Thanks very much, everyone. Great comments, great ideas.